The idea was to create create and develop a higher level system, a more complete system. When I started in the mid 80s working with anti-terrorist units in Israel, I saw that we were missing some sections that were needed for this type of work, for this type of unit. And I brought these things to IMI's attention, and together we developed a whole approach to other sections in the military and the police and the law enforcement and the special units and the anti-terrorist groups. When I'm traveling around the world, and I've been in South America and Central America, and of course here in the States and in Europe, and from Israel, the experience we have, I managed to see different problems, new problems that are evolving or existing in certain areas in the world. The idea behind the self-defense is don't get hurt. Protect yourself, make a hand defense, move your body from the danger zone, make a body defense. Counterattack so the person will not be able to counterattack again, or counter-move, run away so he will not be able to attack you again. And if he has a weapon, and you can, and you need to disarm him, take the weapon from him. Krav Maga training is about control. Especially in training, you have to control yourself so you don't hurt your partner. But when you learn, how to control yourself, when you learn how to control your mental state, your fears, your anxieties, your anger, you prefer much better, you perform much better.
Let's talk Krav. Okay. So we have Krav Maga. Developed by, I guess essentially created by Eamon Lichtenfeld, who worked in the Israeli military. So we have Krav Maga. It's developed for special forces and other individuals that are in law enforcement. Now, that's a very important key thing to remember here, because if we're going to develop a hand-to-hand combat system specifically for people that are in the military and involved in law enforcement, then we have to understand that that means that's not the average individual. That's not someone who is going to be able to afford going to a class 2, 3, 4 times a week and work out for an hour each of those times, maybe a half hour in some cases. So if we're going to learn self-defense and we're really going to learn hand-to-hand combat training, because that's what Krav Maga is, it's hand-to-hand combat training, it's not self-defense training, it's hand-to-hand combat training. And the distinction there to be made is quite simply that the way this guy, or originally Krav Maga, or most self-defense systems have been created for, or not created, have been thought of for the longest time. I mean, this is like a video in the 80s or something like that, and it's like, self-defense should never, ever exceed the format of a conversation. If it exceeds that, then it's no longer self-defense. You're learning hand-to-hand combat training, weapons training of some degree. And that's an important, very, very important thing that I feel like a lot of people just either forgot, deliberately decided to take advantage of, or just simply don't understand. How fast does a bullet from a gun travel? And the very first thing that comes up is 1,200 miles per hour, which I don't even know how much faster that is in kilometers, but that's 536 meters per second. That is very fast. So if you have an individual who's going to do a gun disarm, they're going to have to compare themselves to an object traveling faster than the fastest sports car on the planet times 2, 3, and sometimes 5. Like, these are things that are traveling at crazy amounts of speeds in a very, very short distance, mind you. So if we're going to do a gun disarm, and we're not taking in consideration how fast this bullet is going, I feel like there's a little bit of a disconnect from reality. I mean, gun disarms, if you're close enough to the individual, theoretically, this is important, theoretically, let me pick up the mic. Theoretically, you could be able to maneuver outside of that. But then again, you have to take in consideration that for a gun disarm, right, if a person is aiming the gun towards you and they're not doing the basic laws, but the basic understanding of when you're pulling out your gun is because you're going to shoot, and they're just using it for intimidation, if that's the case, then you still have to take in consideration that the travel that you'll be doing is significantly greater than the travel that they will be doing. They will be doing, holding a gun, imaginary gun in my hand. I don't have one right now. They're holding an imaginary gun in their hand. They're going from here to here. And that changes drastically. I mean, you can, like, if you look at the bottom left-hand corner of this video and you see how quick my finger goes from here to here, the second isn't even over and it's already there. But if you were to move your entire body, it will take a second. It just takes time. These things, like, mathematically, it doesn't make sense on a very, very basic level. And I'm not good at math. So gun disarms, when it comes to Krav Maga or any martial arts system, it's kind of out the window. It's almost absolutely useless. There's that. And then here's a clip of a female who's getting stabbed, right? By a very large, like, this is a graphic image, but here's a couple clips of people being attacked. They don't have Krav Maga training, so that's important to note. But the point of me showing these videos is that, or these clips rather, the point of me showing these clips is that it doesn't matter. Like, it really doesn't matter, because the second that you're already in the confrontation, you're already kind of screwed. I mean, because you could just be sitting on the bus and then have someone come up from behind you for no seeming reason and just stab you in the ear. You could be at the ATM, which has happened, not paying attention, and someone comes behind you with a brick and hits you with it. You could be a pregnant woman walking down the street and with no provocation whatsoever be attacked by two individuals. You could be a police officer trying to do a proper arrest and have someone already attacking you, and then have a mob out of nowhere appear with bats and weapons trying to attack you. You could also be an individual who is a terrible police officer and trying to attack another individual. I mean, this is the reality that we live in, and this is my biggest issue when it comes to self-defense, martial art based systems. You have an idea, and you're taking it, and you're trying to implement it, but you're not being genuine to your own idea, because the concept is fun. Like you're having fun. Like, it's fun to pretend that you can defend yourself against someone with a gun. And it's not that you can't defend yourself. I'm not trying to be like, oh, the second that someone has a gun, you immediately give up. But in some cases, in most cases, that tends to be the best solution for you to do, or the best option for you to take. In very few cases, does it make sense to retaliate with hand-to-hand combat to an individual that has a gun. The gun, this is important for people to understand. The gun, whether it's a rifle or a small pistol or a Barrett, one of the biggest guns out there, sniper rifles, shoots really far, or even a light machine gun. Whether it's anywhere in between those categories, even hunting rifles, right? They will penetrate whatever it is that they're going to be hitting. In some cases, it doesn't penetrate all the way through, but in most cases, in almost all cases, you can die from getting shot. It's this thing that's absolutely baffling to me that Krav Maga specialists specifically will teach their students how to defend themselves. Like I used to do, like I take responsibility for this as well, but that's why I'm doing this video right now. And this is why it's taken me a minute to come together and create this video. You can't teach your students moves that might work. You have to teach your students moves that will work. And those moves that will work are the same ones that I've created that are the rules of techniques. You have to have complete control of your opponent. Here, let me read them off to you because I don't know them off by hand, by memory. Rules of techniques. The technique must have a learned escape. The technique must maintain complete control over the opponent. The technique must allow the user agility in combat. The technique must prevent the opponent from continuing the attack. This is some of the stuff that you absolutely have to have. If you don't have these and you're teaching a system where you're supposed to be able to subdue or not subdue, I don't know if that's the right word, but restrain an attacker or at least maim and or kill an attacker. If you don't have these, then you're teaching fantasy. For the system or art style to be effective, it must apply to not just a type of person, nor a type of selected style as its opponent, but it has to apply to both these basic standards after all, what is, this is like 5 a.m. writing, so bear with me. After all, what good is investing your hard-earned money into something that's simply useless? It's like going to the DMV, okay? So one of the things that I'm trying to say here, well, see, this is, I wrote a book, but it's like I can't write and I can't read either, apparently. But my point is, you have to have a system that is both effective for people of all body types and that can apply to all types of hand-to-hand combat aggressions. And I feel like that's not really talked about enough. I mean, I'm probably high 200s at this point, but I'm a high 200s individual weight-wise. I hit really hard. I have some training. I have a good enough amount of training that I can walk down the streets very comfortable when it comes to any other individual who I can visibly see coming towards me. Surprise attacks, I mean, if it's a surprise attack, by definition, I won't be able to defend myself. But that is what I mean by there's a difference between being able to have a conversation about self-defense and the idea of being able to be skilled enough that you're going to be able to predict when a surprise attack is going to come towards you. But I'm 300, but going on to what I was saying, I'm like, let's say I'm 300 pounds. I'm 300 pounds. I have decent agility. I have decent level of striking. I can hit really hard. And I'm facing off, and someone who is in the exact parable between me would be, say, 120 pounds or 110 pounds or 100 pounds, right? These two people learn the same techniques, but it involves a continuation of strikes. Let's say a flurry of strikes, similar to some sort of Krav Maga thing that we saw with the knife video, right? Now, the falsehood here is that a person who is 100 pounds has the ability to defend themselves against someone who is my size coming at you with that knife, or the person who is 100 pounds. That's not going to work. That's physically impossible. It's not physically impossible. It's just not going to work. You have the weight of that individual coming down onto you, onto your body with a knife. I mean, you're going to deal with adrenaline first off. I mean, you're going to be freaked out. You're not going to know what's really happening. Your technique might not even be as good as you want it to be when it comes to the situation. And if it does come to the situation, why are they going to stop attacking you after one stab? This is another falsehood that Krav Maga and a lot of self-defense systems tend to teach. I mean, thanks to my brother, the founder of the Ramirez Boys Fight House over in New Jersey, like, had it not been for him, literally, we were talking about this exact same thing a while ago. And he said, okay, well, then what happens if I attack you more than once? Now, that's, to me, when he asked me that, I was like, I have no idea. Like, I have no idea. Like, I have no clue. I mean, I played it off super cool. I was like, oh, I'll still be able to defend it. That was a lie. That was a lie. I had no clue. Like, he asked me, and then I was like, what do you mean? Just go show me. And then he proceeded to stab me in the face a whole bunch of times. And I'm just like, it was a plastic knife. And I'm just like, holy crap. I have no ability to defend myself. And it was eye-opening. It was genuinely eye-opening. But it's these things that I'm talking about that makes Krav Maga seem extremely fantastic. Now let's talk about this other thing about how, because law enforcement use it and the military uses it, it's supposed to be some sort of fantastic system of some sort of proven fantastic system of self-defense or hand-to-hand combat training. That's not true. That's simply not true. Here's why. In the military, you're spending at least 80 to, well, depends on where you are, but there's at least a month to 2 to 3 to 4 to 8 months worth of nothing but hand-to-hand combat training. Now, I don't mean like, oh, you wake up, you read a couple books, and you study a few things. In some cases, that's true. In the Israeli military, that was true, especially with our cases. I mean, as we furthered our training, we ended up having to read more and learn more about the weapons that we would be using. But that's also another thing. Not only do we train all of the time, literally all of the time, you have nothing better to do. You literally have nothing better to do when you're a soldier is you train all of the time. So that already puts you at a huge disadvantage in comparison to the average person who works at Google, who works at your local stores at Safeway. The people that we're talking about that are coming to your self-defense classes or any type of these classes, they're regular people. They're paying for the classes for them to learn how to defend themselves. And they're saying that it's good because the people that can train all the time can use it all of the time or use this system. And because they train, therefore it's effective for someone who doesn't train nearly as much. That's simply a falsehood. That's simply not true. I'm sorry, but if you're working any other regular job, whether it's auto sales, whether it's security work, even security officers don't train. Some police officers barely train, and those are supposed to be the people that are the most trained individuals. Let's say you're a congressperson, right? A congresswoman or congressman. Like, you're not training. You're not training. Let's say you're a bus driver. You're not training. Your days are not spent training. Let's say you're a software engineer. You're doing something else that's not training. And that's not bad, but that's important to understand when it comes to a person who's saying, oh, if you come to my class for 4 hours a week, you'll be able to defend yourself against a person who's coming at you with a knife. That's wrong. That's wrong. That's not right. And that's really, really unfair that so many Krav Maga experts have decided to just jump on this bandwagon and completely go through with it. It's ridiculous. It's such a falsehood. It takes years. It takes years, sometimes decades, to be half as good as regular individuals who just train, who have natural skill sets beyond most people's understanding. It takes a long time. I remember when I was in a Kung Fu training for Hungar in a school in Seattle, Washington. I accelerated really quickly. I was good at forms. I was good at hand-to-hand combat training. I was good at weapons. I was good at a lot of things. Meanwhile, you had individuals that have been there for 10 plus years and couldn't do half the things that I could. Now, I'm trying to say this in a sense that I'm not trying to boast myself, but I'm trying to say this in a sense of people learn things at different speeds. Because I happen to be able to learn it better than the person who spent more time in there doesn't mean that the system doesn't work. It simply means that I have a natural advantage towards someone who has a disadvantage, which is a lot of people, towards the hand-to-hand combat system, because it's a lot of work. You do put a lot of work into these things. It's not something that you just magically get overnight. I mean, I spent years. I was in the situation where I literally did nothing but study martial arts, train martial arts for years. I mean, my high school years was quite literally replaced with martial arts training. Like, I didn't do regular high school. Like, I went to high school and I was okay in school, but I didn't care. Like, once my, I don't even know how long I was there. I was there for like 5 hours a day. Once I was there for 5 hours, because I managed to test out of some classes or whatever. Once my 5 hours were up, it was 16 hours or 12 hours. I think that's the actual logical math or something like that. It was like 10, it was 10 hours, right? It was 8 to 10 hours, 8 to 10 hours, 16, 10, whatever, 3 hours or 3 hours. jokes. It was 8 to 10 hours doing nothing but hand-to-hand combat training and or martial arts. So my advantage was that I trained more, and I didn't make it seem like I did. I mean, I would come to classes early, especially during the summer. I would open up the school sometimes. Most times, I think, I would be there hour or two hours early, and I would just be there training for a 2 hour long class, I think it was. Maybe it was 3 hour long. And I would just be training. So I would automatically, every time the class was open, 5 hours right there. And then on top of that, I would be at home and I would be training martial arts because I love martial arts. I really, really do. But my passion put me at a huge advantage for martial arts over someone who was not nearly as passionate. Or maybe they were and they couldn't figure it out the same way that I did. And this is what I mean when I say you can't have a system saying that it's good for everyone. Because not every system is good for everyone. But you can have ideologies that can be put into practice that can potentially help you out better than an ideology that is saying that it's going to be good for everyone. Now, this is where things get a little interesting. I don't like Krav Maga in the slightest. Because it's a falsehood. It doesn't actually teach you how to fight. It doesn't actually teach you how to defend yourself. And it doesn't actually teach you how to be aware of any situation. The only thing that Krav really has going for it is it opens up the idea of anything could be a weapon, which is not wrong. It's just okay. Like, that's it. But then you have classes. Like, this is what I mean. You have essentially people that can't fight on the same level as any genuine boxer. And this is important. I bring this comparison up sometimes, and this is what I mean when I say this comparison. If you have a 10-year person who's been in Krav, does nothing but Krav for, I don't know, let's say 10 years, and they are boxing a boxer, and the boxer has half that experience, that boxer will forever outbox the Krav Maga individual. Now, you might be saying, Solomon, that doesn't make any sense. Krav Maga is about utilizing everything to defend themselves. You are correct. However, one of the best ways to identify whether or not a system is useful is how it pairs up against something that only uses its specific skill sets. If Krav Maga is a hand, leg, ground weapons system, then that means it has to be able to handle a hand-to-hand, strictly confrontation. It cannot. A boxer will forever outbox a boxer, a Krav Maga individual. And my example for this is, let's say, here's my thought experiment. Let's say you have a person who's doing Krav. And this person who's doing Krav has the mentality of coming in, oh, I'm just going to overflow the boxer. No big deal. I could do that. Now, let's say you have 5 years of boxing training, real boxing training, within those 5 years, you're going to get someone who has the idea of wanting to overflow you, or system override you, and that's just throwing a bunch of punches. But there's nothing wrong with that. It's a great style, but it's also very easy to outmaneuver and overcome. One of the easiest ways to outmaneuver and overcome it is just by being patient. Now, if you're patient, you'll eventually see that your attacker doesn't really have the stamina, or you'll eventually see an opening in their movements. Because if you're doing a consistent flurry, you're going to fall into a pattern. It's not a matter of if, you will. And if you fall into a pattern, then they can just read you. And if you get tired, then now they can attack because you've exhausted your entire resources. So now you have a collective fighter that can hit you really, really hard, who's not tired, and they're ready to attack you. So right there, Krav does not have the ability to withstand against a boxer. Now let's say you have weapons versus weapons. Now let's say you have Krav Maga, a disarm, because they're primarily disarming. Because if you look at the military, it doesn't matter if you're disarming, because you have, like, when I was taught Krav, one of the things that's really important to realize is that if you're doing weapons and you're doing a Krav Maga disarm, guess what? You have four other guys that all have rifles pointed towards the person who you're trying to disarm. That is a huge advantage for a person who is trying to use Krav Maga in a scenario where it makes sense, because they can. They have the ability to. Now let's take it back. Let's talk about how you would defend yourself against ground fighting, because Krav Maga does have ground fighting for some reason. So right now, I think the arguably best styles for ground fighting would be submission wrestling and Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. There's no way. You cannot overcome these individuals. Like, you just can't. Like just thinking about it, like, I can't. Like, I couldn't do it. And I'm someone who's trained in Krav. I was a level 3 instructor in that school that I mentioned earlier. I mean, I didn't mention it, but whatever. I was one of the best fighters in school there, but I couldn't handle myself against a genuine submission wrestler. I couldn't handle it at all because the skill sets were completely different than what I was being taught. And now you can make the argument like, oh, well, maybe you didn't really learn real Krav Maga ground training. I don't think that's true. I don't think that's true. I've been in Krav for almost 20 years, most of my life. And one of the crazy things that I've noticed is Krav doesn't really address ground things. It doesn't address it in the military when I was in the Israeli military. It doesn't address it in the private sector in Israel. And it doesn't really address it here in the United States either. And the reason for it is because none of them know. None of them know how to defend themselves from these situations. The real reason is because Helio Gracie was not around to popularize ground fighting. That's the real reason. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. Helio Gracie changed the game when it came to hand-to-hand combat. Like, he did. He showed that it was possible to defend yourself from the ground. It just takes a lot of work. And that's something that's very, very true. It's very, very true. When it comes to almost any traditional martial arts, the reasons why you have, I mean, we'll talk about this in probably another video, but one of the things that you'll notice is it's incredibly difficult for people to actually be successful in hand-to-hand combat training, especially when they do traditional martial arts. And the reason for that is because the requirements for becoming successful or good in hand-to-hand combat training is so, under traditional martial arts, that is so ridiculously high up there. It's not even a matter of like, oh, I'm just going to do boxing for a few years and I'll be able to box. It's not even that. Like I teach at a gym in a city near me. And One of the things that I notice when it specifically comes to new people, it's like the way that they move, the way that new people move compared to seasoned veterans or people that are starting to realize how hand-to-hand combat or how to move your body when it comes to these situations. I mean, the difference between the two is there's a genuine disconnect between what's going on in that person's mind and what they're trying to tell your their body to do. Krav Maga never makes that connection. In boxing, you have that connection because you're thinking. It's all about the thinking because you're going in there, you're trying to move out of the way, and you want to position yourself so that you can come at them with the strongest singular strike, and then you want to be able to do that repetitively over and over and over and over again. Krav Maga's mentality is all about rush, attack, attack, attack. Don't worry about it, just attack and attack and attack. And the problem with that is you never learn how to properly throw your punches. You never learn how to properly attack an individual. You never learn how to figure out whether or not your opponent is preparing to counter one of your attacks. You never really figure out if your opponent is just reading you and they're just waiting to figure out what you have so that they can attack and surgically dismount you. Krav Maga doesn't offer that. It doesn't offer that at all. And the reason for that is because it never needed to. Krav Maga was created. Hear me out. Krav Maga was created for soldiers who have teammates and all have guns. It was created for law enforcement who has backup and also has a weapon and who also is supposed to train regularly. It's not created for your average individual who is a Safeway worker. And I don't mean this in the sense of like, oh, it's so great. I mean this in the sense of it's not good. Your average Safeway worker who is going to your, I'm not trying to like it's just the most, like, I feel like Safeway workers are just the most generic thing that could come to mind. There's nothing wrong with them. I actually love Safeway. That's probably why I'm using it. Like your average grocery store worker, they are quite literally spending, let's say, 40 hours. The government decided that 40 hours makes sense, so 40 hours. Let's say they're spending 40 hours. That's almost 8 hours a day for 4 days on work. So let's say this is the average person. And then from those 8 hours, they're going to be then spending another 4 hours for training. Or are they going to be spending the rest of their day with their loved ones? Or are they going to be spending the rest of the day doing something that is passionate? Maybe training is passionate for them. I don't know. But the vast majority of people that are going to come into these self-defense situations or classes are really just trying to figure out whether or not it makes sense for it. It doesn't. Self-defense systems are scams. This is why I wrote a book about it. And this is why I'm like really, really trying to attack it. Krav Maga is a scam. It always has been, especially when it came to the market here. And one of the best ways that they really solidified this scam was by pairing it up with workouts.
We have worked very hard in Krav Maga to be responsible and to develop the most comprehensive training system in terms of physical fitness, fighting skills, and self-defense skills. And what we've done is we realize that the body must be in good shape to function in a real life.
Because now not only do you feel like you're learning how to defend yourself, which you're not, you're also getting a shitty workout. So it's just a lie. And it's unfortunate. It's unfortunate because I spent a lot of time in Krav Maga. I spent a lot of time in Krav. And I've come to the realization that it's simply not good. It's simply not good. I think Rokas from YouTube, from My Martial Arts Journey, he came to a very similar conclusion when it came to Aikido. And I've never liked Aikido, but this is what I mean, though. The system just simply doesn't provide the appropriate measures it needs to provide in order to be a sustainable martial arts system or a hand-to-hand combat system. It doesn't provide. I think it's called 7-point boxing has more validity than Krav Maga, which was a system that was created in the prison cells for former boxers who wanted to be able to box at each other, I guess, compared to a system that was created for the military. These two things seem drastically different, and the stigma of what is it? The stigma of respectability from an organization overpowers the idea of this just works. And because of that, it's allowed itself to continue being a problem. So this is some of my thoughts when it comes to Krav Maga. I mean, there's a lot to it, but this isn't... Krav Maga is a scam. So in conclusion, there's one thing that I want. It's not my belief. It's not even my understanding. It's not me who's saying... Like, it's not me who's saying this. I am saying it, but it's not me who's saying this. It's martial arts itself. It's hand-to-hand combat itself. That's my stomach. If we're supposed to be able to maintain ourselves in fighting, Krav Maga simply does not provide that at all. It simply doesn't. It simply does not. And before we conclude, I have to make this point because I know there's going to be a couple people that are going to be saying this. Krav Maga is supposed to be a street sitch scenario. Krav Maga is supposed to be something that you're just simply attacking with. Krav Maga is supposed to be something that you can attack the eyes, attack the groin, attack all of these situations, and continuously attack and overpower your opponent. Now, the problem with that logic is those aren't techniques that you need to learn, because everyone knows where everyone's vital points are. We learn them very early on in life. And not only that, there's nothing preventing your attacker from doing the same to you. You know? Like, if you can throw a perfect jab cross, your opponent might not be able to throw that. Because throwing a perfect jab cross, where those three punches almost feel as if they were one, that's something that you have to learn to be able to do. Hitting someone in the groin is not something that you have to learn to do. Happens to people all the time, even by accident, even themselves. They accidentally hit themselves in the groin, poking themselves in the eye. Eye gouges, for example, with Krav. You really think that a person is just going to let you there and stick their thumbs into your eye? You're not going to let that happen. Why on earth would you assume that someone will let you do that to them? Like, oh, but you're supposed to be attacking all the time. Yes, but your opponent doesn't want to get hurt either. Like how does that not make sense? Like you're being attacked. That doesn't mean that your opponent is okay with getting hurt. That means that they're okay with hurting you. That's it. When you retaliate, the hope is that they will remove themselves from the attack. But that's just it. It's just hope. What you need to do is be sure that they're not going to attack you. And Krav Maga sells you this lie of if you hit them in the groin, if you hit them in the face over and over and over again, eventually they'll stop. That's not true. Pain is subjective. Pain varies from person to person. So that's all I have to say on that. Pain is subjective, and that should not be the format of your style. Because if you hit a person enough times in the head, eventually they will stop moving. They will die. If you break someone's legs, they will not be able to come at you. They'll crawl, but you could get away. If you break their arms and legs, they will not crawl. So if you restrict their air from flowing, they cannot breathe. They cannot come towards you. Same thing with hitting a person in the jaw or knocking them unconscious. Krav Maga hopes. That's not how it goes. But if we are talking about how to make Krav Maga better? You can't. You really can't. I mean, you would have to redefine, you would have to redo the entire system. And to be quite honest with you, I don't think there's anyone that's really going to take Krav Maga and then redo the entire system. It either, like, it's just impossible. And I don't mean this in the sense of like, oh, you can't do it. It's not possible. It's impossible in the sense that karatekas will be able to understand that you can't simply just write down everything there is to martial arts and kung fu specialists, especially. You can't just write it down. Like, you can, it'll just take forever because there's a lot going on into the martial arts. There's a lot of it. That's why I'm trying to create these videos, you know, like so I'm trying to address things, make things a lot easier for people to understand and be able to look at things more informed. But in conclusion for Krav Maga, I hope the people that take it aren't taking it in the sense of self-preservation or self-defense. I hope that they're taking it for fun, and I genuinely hope that they're taking it in the sense of it's not super real, because it's not a real martial art, in my opinion. No, in the martial art opinion, it's not a real martial art, or I guess judgment, really, because in the martial arts judgment, it's not a real martial art. It's a scam. It's a scam. Krav Maga is a scam. Self-defense styled systems are scams. They're all scams. So yeah, I mean, it's kind of a somber ending, but the reality is some systems are just bad, and in order to overcome them, we have to address them for what they actually are. Krav Maga is a scam. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. Krav Maga is a scam. This video is already long enough. If you have any questions, if you have any questions whatsoever to me, if you think I'm wrong in Krav Maga, go ahead and hit that like button first, and then come down to the comment section, and then let's hash it out. Or even better, send me an email so that we can communicate even more accurately, or whatever you want to talk about, and we could really delve into Krav Maga and we could really talk about it. But put a link into the video that you're referring to so that I know which video it is that you're going to be talking to, because I am going to try and produce more and more videos. This video is late. I wanted it to be out on Friday by 4 of the 23rd, but it just simply did not work. Yeah, if you have any questions, feel free to ask me anything martial arts related. Anything martial arts related, feel free to ask me. If you want to buy any merch, because we have merchandise, you can go down to the website and then click on clothing, and that'll take you to our website that provides clothing. So there's that. If you want to sign up for private classes or one-on-one or do some hand-to-hand combat training with yours truly, depending on where you are, that's also another thing. It really depends on where you are. But we could also work Skype things and stuff like that. We can also do consultation, so I can help you. I can look through the schools in your area, which if we do that, then I'll make a YouTube video about it. So that everyone can benefit from it as well. And then I'll just do that free of charge for you guys. But yeah, we got consultations. We got everything you can possibly imagine. If you look in the description down below, explore the websites, go check them out. If you're on the phone and you want to look at it up on the website so it's not weird looking, just copy and paste the URL and put it into into Google or whatever. And it'll take you there right away. But yeah, that's been this video. Unfortunately, it's pretty sad about Krav Maga. But I believe in bringing the truth to people, especially when it comes to hand-to-hand combat. It's something that I very much loved, very, very much love, and probably will forever love. And I don't want people to get hurt. I don't want people to get hurt. It needs to change. And here we are. Hopefully this video gets enough recognition that people start changing their habits when it comes to self-defense, when it comes to anything regarding hand-to-hand combat, because the average person who spends 40 hours a week doing their own job and then 4 hours to defend themselves, they're not getting proper training. They're not getting proper training. And we could probably talk about proper training in the future. I don't know what my next video is going to be about, but this Krav Maga video has been something that's been on my mind for a very long time, and I really wanted it to be good for you. And I think this is okay. I think this is a little bit better than what I had beforehand. Because beforehand, let me tell you. All right. Thank you so much. Again, you want to reach out, questions or anything like that, like in the comments. Like this video. Subscribe. Helps the algorithm. Get the word out. Share it with your friends. Even whatever. I don't know. Yeah. But yeah. Share this video. Like it. Comment. Tell me what you think. Tell me how my sound's going. That's important to me. And... yeah. _ out.